Actually,
And
go out of, yeah.
It's working now.
It's okay.
That's all that is needed. Yeah.
All right. So hopefully you see the right thing. All right. Great. So welcome everybody to the first session of CTIS, and it's an absolute privilege to have the opportunity to introduce you to our first keynote speaker, Manish Jain, who is an associate teaching professor here with us at IIT Gandhinagar. He's also the coordinator of an amazing initiative called the Center for Creative Learning, which does very, very wide-ranging work, but also specifically they've been doing some amazing work in the context of computational thinking. In particular, I think they've been helping in recent times, at least among some of the workshops that I've had a chance to collaborate with Manish on. They've specifically helped CBSE teachers, for example, transition into the new syllabus, which requires them to use, say, for example, Python instead of C++ and so on. But as I said, it's impossible to do justice to the amazing range of activities that Manish is involved in. And you can see the official bio on the screen now that it's working. Before joining us, he was with IUCA, and my first memories of, I think, interacting with him was through the foundation program, which is a thing that we do at IIT Gandhinagar for our undergraduate students to sort of help them shake off, the coaching environment that they're coming from. And I think Manish's sessions by far have been, I think, the most popular ones with students, where they really get hands-on and, really, I think his motto has been to make and break things and really learn by doing. And that's something that I think he literally stands by. I think they have an amazing program running right now on YouTube that I think launched last week. So I'm sure he'll tell you more about that. And as somebody who has been to his lab often, I can tell you that that's the main tourist attraction of our campus. So I think whenever we have visitors over, that's the first place that we like to take them to and show them around. It's really uber cool. And so I hope that whenever we have a chance to see you, for everyone who is attending, please do visit. And in particular, I'm sure Manish will be very happy to welcome you to his lab. And as I said, I can barely do justice, but I'm absolutely excited for this talk and looking forward to it. So Manish, the floor is yours. And thanks so much.
Let me just take my time. Thank you so much. Thank you very much, Neil. Awaaz aa rahi hai? I'm just wondering if the awaaz is coming.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, good, good. So I was thinking, aap itni zyada tareef kar rahe ho, so please go ahead, eat all your time. And so, I don't have to speak. I think it is a pleasure. I haven't met Jam ever. I mean, I think we met once in Ahmedabad in one of the conferences for a couple of minutes, but it'll be a pleasure for people who are here. I keep hearing about you guys so much. Please do come visit. It'll be just absolutely fine. It'll be great. And it's always a pleasure to have Neil. Of course, she's, if I can call myself busy, I will call her, on a different league. But absolutely pleasure. I mean, absolute pleasure to come and, for honor to have me here. I don't know how much justice I'll be able to do to come and give this talk. And so thank you so much for that introduction. And I was confused, what is it that we want to talk about, given that this is a forum where I just want to make sure mereko lag raha hai ki awaaz mein kuch lag hai. Is the awaaz clear? Is the voice clear?
So it's absolutely fine.
Yeah, it's okay, perfect.
Okay. Okay, give me just one. So I was just wondering, what is it that we're going to talk about? And so we try to cook something up together. But thank you. Absolutely a wonderful, a pleasure, honor to have all the people here and call me here to give this talk. And I don't know what I'm going to do here, but I'll try to share a few experiences over here. We'll just try to I'll share a few things that we've done in our lab in the last year. Jay is right here with me next, and maybe I'll call him to say hi and say a few words and share a few things also. My name is, I'll take you here. My name is Manish Jain, and this is, I'm calling from IIT Gandhinagar, and this is sort of our standard slide. This is actually, it's raining right now. So this is Sabarmati. It normally fills up. if we have good rains. This year we don't have that much good rains in Gujarat, at least in this part of Gujarat. This is IIT Gandhinagar. This is where we have our lab, and this is what our lab looks like, or it used to look like a while back, and it's an old picture. Sorry about that. You see a lot of these odd looking shapes and things, and we call them polyhedra or convex and concave, and things like that. But that is something that we try to do, build a lot of things that, and this is another picture of our lab where we do a lot of work with teachers and students, and our goal is this gleam in the eyes of our children. I mean, this is what we try to sort of see if we can get. This is something that we try to sort of get. This is the gleam in the eyes of our children. All the work that we do in the lab, we started this lab about in 2017. The idea was to see if we can create curriculum which can engage and which can inspire, if we can do these activities which can engage and which can inspire, if and we try to relate all these things with the curriculum, with the intent to make the curriculum imagine, I don't know if probably you've heard this story, if not, imagine I ask you to do this experiment. Why don't you eat khichdi for 3 days in a row, right? For those who don't know what it is boiled rice and boiled lentils, and no salt, no sugar, no tadka, no bhaji, jalebi, and all of the stuff that you put in, kochambri and whatever else that you put on the side, nothing. So breakfast, lunch, dinner is khichdi. Next day, same thing. Breakfast, lunch, dinner, night. Now try to feel what is going on with you as I speak, as you experience this eating khichdi for 2 days, second day, third day, same thing. Fourth day, if somebody shows you the sight of khichdi, you would want to throw everything that is inside outside. But I think the reason I'm telling this story is this is what I sometimes believe this is what we are doing, and that is why our children are not interested to come to our classrooms, or we are not interested to go to our classrooms. Largely, I mean, of course, this is just to convey. I'm speaking in extremes to convey this point that I think it's our onus. It depends on us. We will have to work. I mean, it is very hard, of course. We will have to try to see if we can make this khichdi more of curriculum interesting and engaging. Now, this khichdi, imagine if we had jalebi on top of it and dhokla and khakra and whatever else we eat in Gujarat. Suddenly, it is more appetizing. And that is what we try to do. We try to create this, if you call it appetizers or side dishes of curriculum, and some of those we are going to talk about, some of those and a lot of these things are not something that you need a lot of money, you don't have to ask for grants, this, that, whatever to do. I mean, this Sunday we did this wonderful program. I mean, of course, I'll call it wonderful, but you'll have to see it for yourself to say whether it was. We did this program called Eklavya, and we call it Eklavya because, and we do this every Sunday, like Neil was saying, I'll tell you a little bit. This is just this Sunday, 4 to 5 on YouTube, live, free, everything, free registration, free whatever. So please do join if you can. If you can spend an hour, of course, I know it is IPL time, and we clash with IPL and we're trying to see who will win, whether we win or IPL, and it is clear who will win. But hopefully we can change, and that's the idea. Hopefully we can make computational thinking and activities that we do interesting enough for people to sort of think, yaar, IPL ki jagah aaj thoda sa ye jam ki video dekhte hain. I think that is the goal. I mean, and of course, I know it's a losing battle, but we still try. And in that, I'm giving you that example because we did this something very interesting, and I thought I'll start with that. And let me show you. This is coming on your screen. So imagine what we have done is the and this is our friend Ashutosh, and what he has done is this is a wooden beam, or you can call it whatever it is, and then we have hung these threads, right, of various lengths, and we have hung a ghanti, ghanti ko kya bolenge English mein, bell, underneath this, right? And now imagine, and of various length, of course specific lengths, and now we will ask Ashutosh to throw this ball and see what happens. And of course we don't have the voice, but you see when he threw the ball, it touched every single bell. And there is a reason why it did that. And there is a reason why these lengths are 1, 4, 9, 16, 24, 25, 36, 49, and so on and so forth, right? And the 10th one is 100. There is a reason. And the reason is that, of course, these are square numbers. And also, because whenever you throw anything straight with zero, I mean, with zero vertical speed, that will fall down with only the force of gravity to pull it down. So its horizontal speed, its horizontal distance will be constant. And that is why the threads that you hang, and let me take you there, these horizontal distances are constant. So you hang them at 10 centimeter each, and you can do them at 10, 20, 30, whatever, or you can put them at 5. Fixed distances, right? So we did at 10 centimeters, and the vertical distances are, like I said, 1, 4, 9, 16. These are all square numbers. And the last one, the 10th one, is 10 square, which is 100 centimeter. This is the length. This is because whenever you throw any projectile or any ball and any body in the air, on Earth, or in, you know, it doesn't matter, on any planet, in the x-axis, in this x direction, where there is no force, and which is what Newton was saying, that if there is no force, it will continue to move. It will continue to move at the same speed, will not change. This will be proportional to time, right? So this distance will remain constant. And in the y-axis, it will be proportional to t squared. So if, and this is the interesting part, and which is why if this is the challenge for you. Imagine now you do the same thing, and you hang your threads of length 2, 8, 18, 32, 50, 72, 98. No big deal. These are just proportional to square, some square number, some n square, right? So imagine you hang it. I mean, it could be whatever it is. And then if the challenge is you do this, hang it at fixed distances. All the threads should be at fixed horizontal distances, and it could be whatever. You can choose it to be 5, 10, 15, 20. And make sure you have those bells sitting there. And then you throw this ball horizontally. Challenge is, sari ghanti bajni chahiye, tan tana tan tan. That is a parabola. That is the definition of a parabola, tan tan. Of course, it should not be tan 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 tan. It should be tan tan tan. I mean, the bells should be at a fixed time. If it is tan 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 tan, clearly it's not a parabola. In the horizontal time, it should take finite, fixed, whatever time instant it is, it should take fixed, I mean, same time to hit the first bell, same time to hit the second bell, which basically means that whatever you threw is traveling at a constant speed in x, and it is traveling constant distances x, which means it has constant speed in x in the horizontal direction, and its speed is changing in vertical direction, increasing linearly, but the distance increases as a square of time. You can do those formulas, right? But computationally, this is very interesting activity. And now you can hang this and throw. And we did this in Eklavya, and we got a lot of messages. Of course, some of them, they just did linear distances. And of course, then it will not work. It has to be square. That is what Newton's first law talks about, that if you throw something, it keeps on the speed. And, you know, because in the gravity, it is increasing. That's why, x is equal to 2 square. And what it also means, and this is something else that we did, and I'm going to show you just in a minute, which also means that if you drop something just like that, and if you flick something horizontally, it will fall at the same time. And you can see this right here. Let me just show you. There you go. FI. Let me just start this again. Oh, okay. I think it happened again. Let me just show you again. So these are all coins going at different horizontal speed, but you see their vertical distance is always constant. And if I drop three people dropping three different things with different speed, they will all land on the ground at the same time. And this of course is the definition of this is how things fall when you throw them. However, you throw yourself, please don't do that, but imagine you can throw yourself from a table or a chair, but don't do it from a high enough ground. But if you do high jump, you do long jump, your center of mass will do exactly the same thing, and you can do this computationally and figure that out. And I'm going to show you something also very interesting. Hopefully I have those slides right here. And this is something, I think, you know, in whatever whatever we do in our schools or in classrooms, one thing that we will have to try to do is to see how we can link whatever we are doing or whatever activities that we do, things that we talk about, whatever is happening in life. And that's why we are saying, by the way, yeah, the slides at the back are saying 30-30 Club. We are spicing. We just have one board, right? I mean, this is my background and we use it all the time. Of course, this is CTIS. Maybe we should have changed, but, you know, sorry about that. We just have this same background and, you know. So the goal is to see how, whatever we are trying to do is to see if we can link that is things that are happening around us within our classrooms, within whatever is happening. So imagine, and the reason I wanted to emphasize on the fact, life, whatever is happening in life. And that's where something very interesting happened. And I'm starting with that, and I'm going to move to do a lot more computational things and computer science things and math things and so on and so forth. But I think it's very interesting. I don't know how many of you read the news or know that there is this person called Neeraj Chopra who won India's first gold medal August 17, 2021 in Tokyo. Right, I mean, he threw the javelin, and of course, he won because he gave it a lot of speed, and he won the javelin. But he threw his javelin at 36 degrees, whereas computationally, if you you know, s is equal to ut plus half gt square, if you try to figure out the range, it will be some equation, and you differentiate it and do all of that stuff, and you get theta is 45, which means to throw the thing at the maximum distance, you will have to throw something at 45 degrees. However, it doesn't work for Neeraj Chopra. It actually doesn't work for a lot of things. And I don't know, I don't have that slide, but for any of the sports, by the way, whether it's javelin or shot put or long jump or whatever, you don't do it at 45. In fact, if you throw a projectile with a gun, you do it at 55 degrees, which is more interesting. And I'm not going to go there because it's a long topic. But all I'm going to show is that this is something we can do computationally. We can go out there in the field and try. And so imagine, beautiful thing, same thing, right? Imagine you throw at 0 degrees, right? And let me take an example to show this to you. And hopefully and this is something that Galileo said beautifully, that if you throw anything at an angle, it is basically throwing same thing at two different speeds. One, this is same thing as throwing something horizontally and something vertically. That's it. And the beautiful thing is that the real thing will happen. It is the sum of these two things. The horizontal thing takes it far, and the vertical thing gives you more time of flight. So for you to go very far, you need maximum time in the air, right? You need this to be maximum. And for you to go very far, you need this also to be maximum. And that's why you sort of try to keep it in the middle, which is 45 degrees, right? And but this is just theory. What happens when you try? And I'm giving this background because I wanted to show you this beautiful thing that our friend Pankaj did, where he went to the ground and tried. So this is zero. And of course, he's throwing from some height. That's why it went a little far. Then it's 15. And this is a 5 kg ball, by the way. This is 45, which fell behind 40. This is 60 degrees. And this is 75. And now he'll try to throw it at 90. So please don't do that. Of course, that can be. And now he's running and throwing. And that's why he's going very far. And now he's trying to do 90. you should not do that, because then it can be, it can be dangerous. So. I'll try to come back. I thought I'll just, I was really excited to show you that clip where, you know, it's interesting. You throw at 90, it's going to come back. In fact, that reminds me of a beautiful story of a Newton's cannon. I don't know how much you've heard that story, it's not a story. I mean, it's a very good theory that Newton sort of talked about. And he said, you know, you have a cannon, and you keep throwing the cannon. Imagine you can fire the cannon at whatever speed that you want. You keep firing, it will go and fall somewhere, then it will go further, it will go further, it will go further, till it hits the maximum point of the earth on the horizon and goes back. And if you keep throwing it at incrementally higher speeds, one time will come at a particular speed that will actually become a satellite with the distance of the height of the cannon. Come back and hit on your you know, so if this is your if this is earth and this is cannon that is sitting at one particular height, the cannon will just go around and then come back here at this particular height. This is my earth, at this height will come back in. So that was all the projectile thing that we did. Sorry, I had these things fresh in my mind. I thought I will in the start show you, tell you this beautiful story about this how a simple equation of a parabola can be computationally done in the classrooms just by hanging these threads and a ghanti and a bell. And the challenge now, it becomes very interesting because now you know, the class is engaged. And it's a challenge that you, and only at a particular speed when you throw, it will hit all the bells and you can hear the noise and I mean sound, and it has to be at fixed time, and the time will all be same. So that is what this this effort that we do at IIT Gandhinagar is about, and this series that we are doing right now on YouTube every Sunday 4 to 5. Today is Wednesday, and of course we have to prepare for the next one coming the next week, and where we talk about acceleration and, you know, mass and whatever. And very interesting story. I mean, just as a preview, I'm going to tell you that we have made a cycle, converted a cycle to a rocket, and we're all going to show you how you can reduce your weight. You don't have to go to slimming centers and VLCC or whatever. Just walk into a lift, and then if you weigh yourself in a lift, you get 4 kgs of reduction right away. No dieting, no nothing. Eat your pizza and reduce your weight, 4 kgs, just stand in the lift. But it doesn't really work all the time, and we will show you. So anyway, coming back, like I said, what we try to do is to see if we can spice up the curriculum. And I think this is really required, because what we are doing is making our children disinterested. And you know, this is what some people were saying about the things that we were doing. It reminds them of a turning point. Some of the feedback that we got before the episode, I'm just going to share in a minute for you. And this is the program that we did last year, we called it 3030 STEM. And the idea was to bring back the beauty, magic, mystery of science and man that exists all around us. 26 sessions, 1 crore views, 75,000 homework submissions. The things that we talked about were, you know, science of music, lungs, machine, cards, cycle mystery, lamps, vegetables, calendar, cricket, pi. This was very interesting. I hope we had time to talk about it, but we did 2 episodes on pi, Pi Day Special and pi. And we showed how pi can be talked about, not from, I think this voice is a little high. How pi exists not just in circles, but in straight lines and things like that. Candles, plants, microbes. Okay, this is the state of the registrations for the program that we're doing right now. You see, there are registrations from almost every part of the country. This is the sort of the graph of how the users are liking it. Once you stop, you can't stop. When whatever, I mean, it's an inverted curve. So once you come in, you sort of enjoy. Okay, so let me in the end just show you this beautiful video of, and I really like this, and I'm going to just share this. Imagine you have a ball with you when you are going on a scooter, and this is. And somebody else is looking, shooting this from the camera. You drop the ball. It seems like the ball will remain behind, the scooter will go forward, but that's not what happens. The ball stays with you. But if you have a camera on you to Pankaj, the person sitting on the ball, it seems like the ball is dropping vertically. But from the outside, it seems. And now if you throw ball vertically, see what happens. To the observer on the scooter, it seems like ball is right on top of their head all the time. You see, it is always on the top of the head. But for somebody outside who shot the film, it is actually a parable. And that is what we try to do. So this was sort of a clip of what we did last week, and I thought I'll just share that. But overall goal of what we try to do is to see how we can bring in activities, stories, and real life in, and introduce that into the curriculum to make sure the content becomes engaging and inspiring. And I think this is what NEP talks about. And this is what CS Pathshala is trying to do, to see how activities can be. And this is something that, you know, there's another group, Computer Science Unplugged, which I think it's out of Norway or New Zealand. I think it's out of Norway. And they have done beautiful work to see how computer science, interesting things in computer science can be done out of. Jack, can we get that up it up? Just see if we can. Or the film. Beautiful thing. I mean, it just reminded me that I've forgotten that this is what we will try to do. So what we try to do, and this is something we learned during 30-30 STEM, that we will have to try to do, you know, activities. We do stories which inspire, and then interaction. And of course, the questions which stay in your mind. Absolutely amazing questions. I mean, this is something that... thank you so much. Okay, so a bunch of things lined up, and maybe we will start with something like I was saying, you know, we'll have to sort of do two, three things. One, we have to make sure activities that we do are interesting. Absolutely amazing activities, things that do not require a lot of material, but things that can be done just with hand and some simple stuff. And I'm going to show you some of those. And of course, we'll not have time to see all of those, but some of those that are really interesting. So activities that inspire, real life things that we can get in, integrate and link with the curriculum, and questions that are absolutely engaging. And the first one is right here on your screen. And Neil and I have spent a lot of time discussing this question and what is the best way to explain. And, you know, we also wrote a lot of simulations to explain it. Maybe we'll not have time, but I will actually share with you this beautiful, beautiful question. And maybe it's actually, well, Jay, can you get that Einstein clock? Either. So this is our Einstein's clock, and you see written right here, and I'm just going to take some stuff off. So imagine this is a clock, and something special about this clock, right? As you can see, we are calling it the Einstein's clock, but of course for a reason, and I'm going to tell you in a minute. But you see something special about this clock, and the special thing about this clock is that both the hands are exactly same, right? So imagine this is the clock that stays behind in every single classroom, in every home, in every house. All we have done is open this clock up, chop the needles, make them same size, and put them back. Of course, koda todna, khodna, jodna, whatever, make and break, open and make. You can do all of that, and put it back together, of course, otherwise the parents will be unhappy. And the question is, can you tell the time? And the reason we are calling it Einstein's clock is for the same reason. This is the question that was asked to Einstein when he was sick in 1918. A friend, one of his friends gave him this clock, of course not this clock, otherwise he would be very rich in the lab, some other version of that clock. And the question that he asked was, can you tell the time? Einstein was, of course, after general theory of relativity, and he was actually, he was stressed, and stories claim that he was resting in a hospital in 1918. And so he said, can you tell the time just by looking at the clock, not by looking outside and telling time of the day? Of course I can, right? I mean, so imagine if it is, like this, right? And I can say, this has to be 8 o'clock, right? Because otherwise it cannot be eight, it cannot be the other way, right? I mean, this is the minute hand. It cannot be 20 minutes before 12, because then this hand has to be a little before 12, right? But what about this? So then it is clear that you can tell the time, right? The question then, interesting question was, how many times can you not tell the time? So if you have this clock, how many times in a day will a situation happen where it is ambiguous? For instance, what we were just doing, right? Let's say if this is the case, right? It could be a few minutes after 8 or few minutes to 2, and you don't know what it is, right? Because they are exactly right there in the middle, right? So how many times in a day can that happen? And we can solve this computationally. We can write, a bunch of things, maybe some equations, maybe think a little bit more. Maybe just, of course, first thing is to make that clock and just observe it. What is going on? What are those times? And then, I mean, the idea of all of this is to see if we can look at some of the patterns that are emerging. And you will find it very interesting. And then we went on and did something more, even more interesting. We said, what is this thing in your clock? Now it is even more interesting. There are 3 meters and we don't know which one is minute, hour or seconds. And even more interesting, we don't even know where the top thing is. We don't even know where 12 is. So we don't know if you have to hang it like this or like this or like this. I assume that you have to always keep it flat because then you don't know. So now can you tell the time? And it's an open question. And I don't think we have answers yet. Just assume. And it will be great for you to just think about it computationally and figure out how many times can I tell the time, and can I tell the time first, and how many times in a day can I not tell the time, right? It is ambiguous. And assume perfect analog clock, all the times, this, that, whatever, right? I mean, all the times are valid. It's not a digital clock where it just moves in, digital quanta or whatever we call them. So imagine, I mean, these are the kind of things I feel if we can engage, if we can have these questions that stay in the mind, raat ki neend aur din ka chain aise bolte hai na, wo ud jayega. And if we can do that, we can engage, we can inspire, we can push our, it was actually interesting, I think it was yesterday or day before, the state of Goa is doing something very wonderful, and they're trying to introduce robotics and, computational thinking as a part of curriculum from class 6, I think. And a very good friend of ours, Saish Gandhi, he's trying to do, he's sort of leading that effort from Goa Education Department, and he called us. He called me yesterday or the day before, and he said, and I told him about this conference. I said, you should come and join the conference. I think he's watching. And he had this very interesting thing. He said, what we are doing, whatever in computational thinking we are doing, he said, what if we introduce a robot in the computational thinking, whatever robotics course that we are doing, and instead of, the scratch doing whatever it is, it does, we have this robot, and we put a pen in there, and then we ask it to draw a line, this, that, whatever. And so suddenly, if something moves in X, something moves in Y, we can show, whatever scratch does is happening actually in real life. And then if we can also add a Z direction, then it is basically a 3D printer, right? I mean, that is all a 3D printer does. And to that, my suggestion or my addition to that activity to Saish was, I think we should not just stop at asking, this machine to draw a straight line or this or that. We should ask, what happens? How much should I move in X? How much should I move in Y so that it draws a straight line? That is very interesting to me. And that is a question that is very computationally interesting. So long as these two movements are proportional, linearly proportional, whatever that constant is, if I move one here and one here, one here and one here, one here and one here, it'll of course be a straight line with us. Exactly in the middle, 45 degree, we just talked about, but it could be the other way. You can move two times here and one time here, again will be a straight line. So long as your speed or your distance in these two directions stays constant, right? Proportionally constant, it's a straight line, right? And that is what a straight line is. Now imagine I asked you to draw a circle, what will happen? That is a computationally interesting question. How do I make this robot draw a circle? And this is what we did. I hope I can show you that. Jay, can we have that car sine wave? This is what we did. We made a car which, when moves, draws a sine wave. And for that, anything that you have to do, I mean, whenever you, and let me take a, make show you a slide. And this is right here. So if I call something a sine wave, what happens is in this direction, I'm going X or whatever, linear movement, but here the distance that I move in the Y, it is sine of X, right? However my I have moved, and this is exactly what happens. My camera, I don't know if the camera is this camera. Oh, working. I'm just setting up my camera to sort of do this. It, it, and दे सकते हैं। नहीं नहीं सॉरी कागज है यहाँ पर। So this is what exactly the robot which will be in Goa's classroom will try to do. So you see this car, and when I move this car, this car has a dandy broken. So let me try to see if we can fix that. Can the dandy done? Very good. Okay, so let's see. Ah, there you go. And move this pen here. So what happens, you see, is the car moves in the X and the pen moves in the Y, but both of them, like any 3D printer or anything, they are moving in a straight line, right? The pen is, the car is moving in this direction, and the pen is moving, you see, always perpendicular to the car. So if you're sitting on the car, you will see the pen moves in Y, it always moves in a straight line. However, what it draws is a sine wave, which means that this distance is sine of some, this distance. If I call it X, this is sine of X. And that's what it is drawing. The question is why, or you can call it cosine X or whatever. As in fact, it is, if this is my origin, it is 1 minus cosine of X, but it doesn't matter. We can call it, a sinusoidal wave. The reason it does that is because that is what we define as, that is the definition of a sine function. You see, when I spin this car, and I'm going to show you the car right here. When I move this wheel, this gear moves, which spins this gear, it moves this disc back and forth, and it takes, this disc spins, and the pen moves back and forth like this, right? It moves back and forth. This is the Y direction, right? And so that's why and let's say it moves till here, the amount of distance that the pen has moved is this much, right? And I can draw this right here on your screen. For you to see, which will explain why this thing is drawing a sine wave, right? If this is my circle and this is my pen, from here the pen has moved till here, which means the distance it has moved, if this is my angle, this is the distance it has moved in Y, and this is actually sine of this angle. That's why, and the how much the car has moved in this direction, it is the radius of the wheel times theta. This is X, and in the Y, and let's say this is radius of that upper disc, it is d times sine theta. So if X is some constant theta and Y is d times sine theta, then what it will draw will be a sine wave. It is guaranteed, because that is how you define this thing. If you were to call it, instead of sine, you were to call it let's call it CS part, whatever, foo. So then this will be a foo wave or whatever it is, right? So the reason it's a sine wave is because that's how we have defined a sine function to be, this perpendicular ratio of this perpendicular to this, and assuming this is linear, this is but we did something even more interesting, and we said, what if we change something else in this car? And now, instead of, it'll still move back and forth. But, and let's try to draw the wave again. But it'll do something else now. And let's see what it does. Hopefully it'll work. Let's see. So you see, and I'm trying to trace, I will just trace this for you. as opposed to before, what it was doing was like this. And this is a triangular wave. Why does it do that? I mean, it is still going back and forth, but this time the amount of, and this is what, you know, the amount of distance going here remains the same because this is connected to the, how much the car moves in this direction because of, you know, this wheel spinning, because of which this gear on top is spinning and it takes this thing back and forth. But the amount this guy moves back and forth is dependent on this gear and that angle, and both things are, you know, so X is the wheel times theta and Y here is that small gear. So both of them are proportional to the angle moved, and that's why it's a straight line. And that's the idea. And we can sort of show that. I this was not part of the script. I don't know. We just ventured. Part of the script, meaning we were not planning to. It just happened, so Jay had to come and help me here. Lots of things. I'm actually a little confused as to what is it that we want to do. But you know, give me some time, and I'll try to. This is something very interesting. Hopefully you like it. My camera works. Yeah. Okay. Overhead. Overhead. There you go. So what I have is a bunch of cards with me. All right. And I don't know if you've seen this before or not, but this is very interesting. One of the most delightful things that I feel we've done. And we have done this with Jay wo Ramayan cards bhi dikha denge. हाँ, वीडियो छोड़ दो, असली के देखो, यहाँ पर होंगे देखो. सो व्हाट आई हैव इज बंच ऑफ दिस कार्ड्स ए टू सी, राइट? एंड कार्ड्स वो पतले हो गए, ए टू सी, एंड दीज आर नॉट सो, ऑफ कोर्स, एंड दे हैव सम होल्स इन देयर, राइट? एंड द गोल इज टू सी इफ आई कैन सॉर्ट देम और ब्रिंग देम बैक टुगेदर, राइट? सो लेट्स सी इफ आई हैव टू सॉर्ट. I will try to get A on top, and of course A is, I don't know, A is, ah, there it is, A. Now I'll have to try it B, and I saw B, B is here, and I'll have to do C. I mean, it is getting very painful or cumbersome, and I don't want to, this is C, right? I don't want to do this, right? I mean, we are all mathematics and science and, you know, fast people. We want quick results. So what I'm going to do is use this small dandy, small safety pin, small stick, and bunch of holes. I'll put this stick in this hole, pull all the cards out. You see, they are all sorted. If you are, you should believe me, they're all sorted. They are not in order. Okay. And something very, very interesting happened, and I hope I'm able to convey Udit Sanghi's story right after this. And hopefully, I don't think I can share that paper yet, because Udit says it is still, you know, wherever it is, but I'll share this beautiful story. This is third, three holes ho gaye. Okay. This is fourth hole. I put my stick in, pull all the cards out, put them in front, and then the last one. Okay. And you see what happens. All right. So these are our cards, and they are sorted. You see, magically something happened. Now they are all sorted, right? And what is it that we did? We just had these holes, which are which you know, if you put this in, they will come along with the stick, and the other one which will not, right? And we have 5 holes and 26, and maybe you can figure out what is it that's happening. This is actually called radix sorting. Somebody is saying, in spite of you seeing this, I don't know who that where that comment was. This is something to do with binary. Yes, of course. By the way, Neil, if you are okay, we can totally have questions, comments. You can totally interrupt me all the time. You don't have to be on mute or whatever. We can keep this interactive. Otherwise, I'll keep on speaking. And yesterday, and of course, when I do this recording, I don't switch my fan on. Because otherwise the noise is there, and of course a little bit later I'll be all sweating. So please give me some time to also, drink some water or whatever. and please feel free to ask anybody who's here. I mean, okay. So let me take a minute and convey this, right? And I think the activities that we do or show is not important. I think it is not important at all ki humko radix sorting to bata diya, ab card se binary kaise karenge aur ternary kaise. The point is not that drishti badal gayi to shishti badal gayi, nazar badal gayi to nazare badal gayi. I don't know how to say this in English, but what I'm trying to say, I think the goal is to see if we can, at least this is what I feel. I feel if we are able to convey that this is, this, I mean, isko English mein kaise bolenge? Drishti badal gayi, shishti badal gayi. It is a little hard for me. I mean, we get these hate mails sometimes, and I don't know what to do. And that's why I'm sharing this story with you. So when we did this episode just now, we got this email, somebody. So if somebody sends you a 12-page A4 handwritten mail, 12 A4 sheets, right? Either they are really pissed off, or they are really super. I mean, nobody sends you 14 pages of A4 sheet written. And most of it was that, you were speaking in Hindi and everybody else is English, and Hindi is not the only language in India, and all of that. And I apologized. And we are doing this Hindi not because I have anything against any other language or whatever. It's just that, when I'm speaking my mind or whatever it is, I feel more comfortable. That's all there is to it. But I realized we totally at the lab, we realized that a lot of people are non-Hindi speaking people, and so they do not understand all of that and they want to. So what we did was, at 6 o'clock when the episode ended, 8:30 we sat again and redid the whole episode in English. So from now on, whatever we are doing two things. I mean, of course, copyright, almost copyright. I mean, I don't know. Maybe we'll tell some other story, some other joke in the middle, but largely the content remains the same. Or maybe not. I mean, I just improvised. I showed you sine wave and triangular wave, which was not part of the script. So, the directors can blame me, but the director of this script can. But what I'm trying to say is that the idea is not to showcase all the activities, because there are millions, but whatever, however many. But the main agenda or main focus of the talk is to convey that this is what can make classes content engaging and inspiring. And it is even more important now, especially more important in these times when teachers are not meeting children and children are not meeting children, children are not meeting children and teachers, and maybe they're happy for that, not meeting teachers. It doesn't have to be like that. All that means is that this problem has exacerbated during these pandemic times. If we keep on doing the same way, in fact, somebody had this beautiful research, it came out of Azim Premji University. They said, during the pandemic times, the learning levels have gone back 1 year, 1.5 years. I mean, whatever that means, right? Our children have gone back 1.5 years of learning, and they were saying, next thing they were saying was, if we keep teaching the same way, we will be 4 years behind if the children come to the class and we keep doing the same thing. Because then they are not interested. They are not interested at all. They are looking outside and they, all of that stuff. So we will have to spend a lot of time. Otherwise, on the online thing, Neil does this beautiful course called, computational programming on NPTEL. And, bunch of people join, right? 8,000 odd. It's just amazing how 8,000 odd people are joining plus. And I think I could be wrong with that data. So pardon me, Neil, for that. But lots of people are joining that course. And it has to be, because the content that we're trying to show or showcase or do is something that engages you, right? And that is the overall goal. Can we sort of bring the right context, bring the right stories, bring, I mean, yesterday I was having this discussion with this very interesting professor, colleague, Professor Michel in IIT Gandhinagar. We were having some discussions about Galileo, where Galileo was saying, one of the things that he said was the earth spins on its axis and spins very fast. And the others were saying, oh, how can somebody so heavy spin on its own? Lots of people were complaining. And the story goes on in a very interesting way. He was actually put under house arrest for having these views. And actually, he died 2-3 years later because he was confined to the house by the state. Just for proclaiming this view that the earth spins on the axis. Right? And the others were saying, oh, if the earth spins on axis, why don't we fall away? Why don't we, you know, fly away? And because if you spin, you fly away. And why is it that, you know, if you jump, you know, earth will go away and you fall somewhere else? And this is the same question that Varahamihira asked about 800 years back. And this is what Michelle told me. And I thought that was very interesting. If the earth is spinning on its axis, people were asking Varahamihira, ki bhai, agar aisa hai, toh why is it that when birds leave their nest, when they come back, the nest will have gone somewhere else? Why? How come they come back to their own nest if you are saying the earth is spinning? Now, I mean, these are interesting questions. And you can, I mean, I can ask this question in another way. I can say, what if I throw you up in the air very high, or you go up in the helicopter very high in sitting in Bhopal? By the time half an hour later you come back, you will be in Ahmedabad because the earth is spinning from west to east. It takes almost around 30 minutes for the sun to move from, and notice what I'm saying, right? From sun to move from Bhopal to Ahmedabad. I mean, yes, clearly sunrise in Bhopal happens at whatever time, and sunrise in Ahmedabad will happen 30 minutes later. So it takes about 30 minutes for, you know, you can say earth to spin or moon. I mean, how do I even know that earth is spinning or not spinning? Imagine you are in a... So I think these are the questions we should not shy our people away. I mean, very computationally interesting questions too. I'm just adding that term, but it is very interesting. Imagine you are in a room, your windows and doors are all closed. Closed room. Koi batti nahi hai, and light hai. Assume kar sakte. Tube light. Okay. Tube light, but no doors, no windows, nothing. You are in a room, you have a thread, you have a ball. How do you tell the earth is spinning? I mean, very interesting. I thought it was very interesting. And when I thought and read and found about it, it was very interesting. And maybe you should think about it. If you think you have some answers, send us an email. You know, you'll find our email, ccl@itgn.ac.in. CCL is Center for Creative Learning, ccl@itgn.ac.in. Or if you Google search, you'll probably find it. So I think I started on this some other track by saying that I might not be able to show a lot of things that I had prepared for given the time. But the most amazing thing to convey is that we will have to make this curriculum rich with activities, rich with context and stories that inspire, that people feel, oh, if I miss this, if I drink water, maybe some story will come and I'll miss. And, you know, imagine Three Idiots, right? I mean, beautiful story. So three things, right? And I sort of, maybe I should, I mean, this is what I think is a benchmark of a good, I would say a lecture or a curriculum or whatever it is. Right? Three things. And very quick, I know Neil likes Bollywood, so I'll give that example. So imagine Dhamaal, right? Dhamaal, right? And there are three benchmarks on which you have to be good at. Right? Does it cover the curriculum? When I say cover the curriculum, whatever it is that... Sabse pehle, no, maja aaya, maja. First thing is, maja aaya kya? Did you enjoy? So now think Dhamaal. I don't know how many of you have seen Dhamaal. I'm not propagating Dhamaal, but somebody told me it's a enjoyable movie. So imagine whatever enjoyable movie, right? It enjoyable, yeah, very good, maja aaya. So one axis ticked. Maja aaya, curriculum cover hua kya? Whatever I wanted to convey in terms of parabola, in terms of equation, in terms of sorting, whatever, was I able to convey that? That is second thing. Did I talk about or cover the curriculum? That is Tare Zameen Par. Okay, Tare Zameen Par, covered the curriculum, maja bhi thoda aaya. And then did it have some sort of an impact on me? Did it make some sort of an impact in my life, on my thinking, on my learning, whatever it is? Kuch asar hua kya? And that I think is Three Idiots. So covering the basa aaya, curriculum bhi cover ho gaya, aur zindagi mein thoda sa to asar pada. Thoda sa to asar pada. Apni zindagi ke 30 second rewind karke dekho ya 30 minute rewind karke dekho. Aaj kya soch kar aaye the, kya karenge? Apni zindagi ke 30 second rewind karke dekho. I think that should, if that stays in our head, I think the classes can become absolutely amazing. Hum ye soch kar jayenge ki aaj kuch mazedar cheez batayenge. Hum bhi class mein isliye aayenge ki aaj wo badhiya madam sir kuch badhiya cheez karayenge, kuch maza aayega, kuch maza aayega. I think if we can keep Three Idiots, by the way, I hope I'm not propagating anybody's film, but I'm really a big fan of this Three Idiots film. I've seen it maybe 60, 70, whatever numbers of time. So I'm not propagating, but maybe I am. I don't know. But they have not endorsed us, and like the standard, whatever it is. ठीक है जी, आगे बढ़ते हैं. एक्सप्लेनेशन इज वेरी नाइस.
So I remember Manish, you were saying that you are open to being interrupted. And
yes,
so
yes, absolutely, totally. Gives me time to drink water.
Right, right, absolutely. And I think there was one question that shown up in the Q&A with, I think, Saish Gandhi asking if you're...
Yeah.
The thing that you showed with the cards, right? When you shuffle them and, you know, everything fell in place magically. So that remark was from me in the chat. I mean, every time I see it, it's insane that, you know, that this works out so beautifully. But the question here was, is this similar to the method of sorting cards in the Babbage machine? So would you want to comment on that?
Yes, yes. And let me then, absolutely. I mean, you know, the way computers were done before, these are the cards right here. You know, they had these punch cards, right? That is how, you know, this is essentially a zero and a one, right? I call this a zero, and this thing that is open, I call it a one. And that is what I have done on all these things. And then I didn't stop here. So this is something that I think I was reading some very old book, and I found this is how we do it. Then we extended, and this is unique. This is what we did in our lab. We said, why do we have only two type of holes, right? Why don't we have three kind of holes? And then we can do, and let me show you that, right? Hopefully I can show you that. Jay Dandini.
So while you're picking things up, I should probably say that I think in terms of the official schedule, we wrap up in about 5 minutes. So
okay. So then I'm not going to show. There were so many things that we had to show. I'm sorry about the time thing. Overhead. Sorry about that, Neil. So this we have done in three different ways, right? This is ternary sorting, right? And this is, of course, all radix sort. But here you go. Three kind of holes. This is zero. This is one. This is two. Right. And then I can keep doing various kinds of holes and with sticks, and I can, you know, sort them with just three holes. And I can do four holes, five holes, six holes, whatever type of holes. And then you can sort whichever way you want. If you do that, send us an email, send us the picture of how you did. You're very happy. And we did. I mean, you can teach Ramayana, right? You can teach whatever else, history, computer science, you know, in chemistry, they do this periodic table. Imagine all of that can be done by you know this simple card that we have. I wanted to show ran out of time. Kenji. CTIS. I have CTIS right here with me. Drishti Shishti, if you change look. Okay. And because we're running out of time, I'm going to do this. This is just for this conference. I have this four piece of paper with me, and I have this single sheet, and what I'm going to do is cut. Time ka mismanagement ho gaya thoda. And you see what I'm going to do is cut in a straight line, right? These are four pieces of paper, and I'm cutting them in a straight line. And one piece fell off, and you see, and I'll just change to overhead, and you can see this four. This is what is left. I did move my paper in a single direction, and something very interesting has happened. This is C, E. This is I, and this is X. So that is my friend Jay, also standing right next to me. CTIS. This is the conference, and this is single cut CTIS. I moved my scissor in one straight line, and all these four letters came out of the paper. And we were very inspired by this work by Eric Demain, single cut. You know, we sort of extended it to work for every single letter. This is called single cut. We do a lot of work with paper, and I don't know if I'll have time to let me just quickly at least try to you know, I don't think we'll have
slides.
Okay, so Manish, I think I have, as usual, miscalculated a bit. I think we would like to allow for 10 minutes, 5 to 10 minutes of Q&A so that folks have a chance to interact with you. But sure. Even for that, I think you have like 5 minutes to go around. Say.
Sure. I'll just quickly do this. So I don't know if you can see this picture. This is a picture we took in IIT Gandhinagar, and you see a bunch of leaves on this grid. Can you tell where is Phi? I mean, I'm going to leave you because of lack of time. I'm going to leave you with a lot of questions, right? Can you look at this picture, take a picture for with your mobile phones or whatever? Can you tell me how you can calculate? Where do you see pi in this picture? There is no circle. And there is no, you know, whatever circle moving this, that or whatever. And can you tell me where is pi, right? And if you do, let me know. Again, this is something called a cardioid. This is a circle when it spins. Ye video hai kya? Nahi. This is a circle that is spins, you know, imagine a circle right here. And this is a point, this is a trace of that point. It sort of looks like this thing looks like a sort of a semicircle. It is actually not, it is called a cycloid, sorry. And the most amazing thing is in a circle, this ratio of this thing to this straight line, which is the diameter is pi. However, this, which is whatever it is, however, this length is 8. So you have pi when the circle is standing, but when the circle starts to translate or move, the pi disappears. Gayab ho gaya. In the cycloid, cycloid, there is no pi. You can try and do this on your own. Just take and measure its length, no pi. And Kalakar ki video, beautiful thing that we did. I wanted to show you the only unique thing that we made in this lab. Beautiful mathematics and computation and machine all in one. Hopefully you can see the awaaz. Neil, can you hear the voice?
Yes. This wonderful machine can draw millions of mathematical shapes. Designed at CCL IIT Gandhinagar by Akash, who is an ITI graduate, and Udit, who is a 12th grade student and an Olympiad medalist. At CCL, we always strive to create things which can engage and inspire. And in that journey, we came up with a unique idea to combine 3D printer technology and spirograph to create Kalakar. Millions of very non-intuitive patterns and drawings can inspire, and math behind each of these patterns can keep one engaged till eternity. Fix the first stick at the centers, the other stick at equal radius, and of course we draw a line. But hold on, if we start to move the screen, now what we get is a circle. So rotating the screen converts the line into a circle. One can wonder why, and there is very interesting trigonometry principles buried here. Now rotate both the sticks with different radii and you get an ellipse. Moving the screen converts this ellipse into a circle. Move the screen in opposite direction and we get a smaller circle. Move the table off center and speed says non-multiples and you get this beautiful pattern.
So you saw this beautiful machine. I have Jess sitting right here. Jess, you can just say, So I hope you saw that the Kalakar thing, the machine that we made, the most amazing thing. And now imagine we have this. This was completely designed, made. We have not yet patented or whatever. But you know, we were having this discussion with Neil. Should we sort of do this on, what is that platform called?
Kickstarter.
And see if people want to get their hands on. Absolutely amazing. Doesn't exist. Unique. Aap kahin dunya mein jaoge to nahi milegi. And the idea, the most fascinating thing about this was, you draw a straight line, is a straight line. Neeche se dharti hila di. Uski table ghumne lagi to straight line ka gola ban gaya. Now, why did that happen? If I make an ellipse, so long it's okay. But if I move the table, the ellipse becomes a circle. Now, imagine if this is what our children play with. And it is not very expensive, right? You can make it on your own or you know, if and when we put it on Kickstarter, get us, you know, send us. Apparently, I heard that Kickstarter, you can do only if you do minimum 100 or 5 or whatever. And I didn't know ki hamare 5 log bhi usme dalenge ki nahin. So isliye humne kuch kara nahi usme. But if you make it on your own and then, you know, imagine ek ellipse ban raha hai aur table ghuma di to ellipse ka gola ban gaya. Iski galat, ye jab tak sawal क्लास में नहीं आएगा इसके बारे में सोचेंगे नहीं एंड गिव मी एन इंट्यूटिव आंसर आई कैन राइट कोऑर्डिनेट ज्योमेट्री एंड यू नो टेल यू व्हाटएवर इट इज यू नो बट टेल मी हाउ इंट्यूटिवली एन एलिप्स बिकम्स अ सर्कल इफ यू स्टार्ट टू मूव द टेबल अंडरनीथ धरती हिल गई तो एलिप्स का सर्कल बन गया क्यों हो गया ये हमें पता चले मैं थोड़ा जल्दी जल्दी बोल के सॉरी व्हेन आई स्पीकिंग फास्टर आई गो टू हिंदी सो आई लेट मी गो बैक टू इंग्लिश एनिग्मा जय इज प्रॉम्प्टिंग मी कि क्या क्या बताना ऊपर है एनिग्मा कहाँ है
So this might be of interest. Manish Binay is asking if there's a catalog of activities available or is there a forum?
Sure. We'll do that. We'll zoom me dal do. CCL, I mean, go to our website, ccl.itgn.ac.in and I think, but just send us an email or slash products or something, right? On our lab, there is.
Yeah. So I just wanted to be sure that that's where you want to send people. So I'll.
Yes. And,
I'll figure that out. Yes, thanks.
So this is what I wanted to show, and one of our most prized, if I can use that word, things. And this is absolutely, and in fact, IIT Gandhinagar is the only place in India, in my knowledge, which has this machine. This is called the Enigma machine, and this is the machine that is that was invented to you know, this was the machine because of which the first computer was invented. Right, Second World War. Germans were using to communicate. Allies had this, but still could not break the code because absolutely amazing mathematics that goes in and very simple and machine. And this is something that we made in our lab in IIT Gandhinagar. I don't think it exists anywhere else. It has about 2000 parts, 2000 moving parts, 3 rotors. A plug board, and you know, you punch in a code and then out comes the answer, but when you punch in one code it moves, and so the code has changed, and so now A has been converted to a D, but you know, because the rotor has spun now, and it's a, now A will become to something else, some other letter, right? And so if you have to decode the message, you need to know the starting code of the machine, only then you will be able to do this. We made this machine in our lab in IIT Gandhinagar. It took us about 4 months to make this, 4 to 5 months with our own hands. And it felt very good that we are the only place in India. And I think we should have this. We should make this because this is why the first computer was invented, to break the code of this machine called the Enigma machine, which is computer science, math, and electrical engineering all come together. Computer science, mathematics, and engineering, mechanical and electrical, it works because of short circuiting. Right, A gets short circuited to D, and that's why A, when you push A, B ki batti chal jati hai. Par ek rotor ghum gaya, ab A dobara dabao to B nahi chalegi, ab kuch aur chalega. And it is happening because that electrical connection inside. Beautiful. I mean, of course, this machine was responsible for a lot of deaths that happened in Second World War. But I think computer was also invented the code to break the code. Like I used to say, computer was not invented to play PUBG, probably, or maybe it was. But it was invented to sort of, you know, first computer was invented to break the code of this machine. So it is absolutely amazing. So now imagine you have this real machine. You can have a simulation of this machine, which is also what we did in GeoGebra. I think it is exists on our website, the simulation of this machine. But it'll be very interesting for you to come and make this machine on your own or see. And I think the last thing that I'm going to show you is that's it, Neil. Is this beautiful thing that we did with paper? In fact, since we don't have time, I will just send you to this. First episode that we did in 3037 last year. It is called. Kagaj pe charcha or something like that. So you just have to search for in YouTube or Google, search for 3030 stem and paper, and you will see this interesting, very amazing thing which is to do, and beautiful thing, right? And the idea is right here. So if you imagine, you have, this is A4, this is A5, A6, A7, A8, A9, A10. Subsequently it becomes smaller. And this guy is just half of this. Green is half of red. This blue or purple, whatever it is, half of green. Yellow is half of this. Half meaning area-wise half, which means that the you know, dimension wise it is square root 2, and so the idea is, where will this converge if this angle is 90 degrees? But if what if I converge this at some other angle, right? If I keep putting these papers at some other angle, where will be the converging point? And it sort of comes like a spiral, but the point is, where is it, this, what is the point of convergence? And the beautiful thing about this is, you don't have to know a lot of very interesting or complicated mathematics. Very, very amazing. Multiplication by n and multiplication in I complex plane. And that reminds me with this story, and with that I'll stop. Last story, right? And I was absolutely inspired when I heard this, right? This person called Richard Feynman gave a talk in 1962 in Cornell on physics. And people were clapping after that talk. I haven't heard anybody clap after a physics talk of 60 minutes or 55 minutes, right? Never, ever in my life. I mean, not that I've gone to a lot of physics lectures, but whatever I have gone to in my college in IIT Kanpur and the six courses that I did in Stanford, nowhere, nobody has clapped after a 60-minute lecture. 1962, Cornell, the video recordings are on, audio recordings are on Caltech's website. Please do watch this episode. Lecture number 22, Feynman's lecture of physics. I also read that book. It was there. It is still there. And beautiful. I mean, people clapping at the end of physics course, physics lecture. And all he's showing is the most beautiful equation in mathematics, which is e to the power of minus I pi, e to the power of I pi is minus 1. And he says that I'm not going to show the proof of this equation because this is like the gem of mathematics. And if I don't spend an hour putting it in the right place and garnishing it and putting it in some sort of a ring, I'm doing disservice. And he goes on and he starts with the first root of 10. First root of 10. Yeah, you know, 10 to the power of 1 by 2. Of course, you can figure out, and does it 10 times. And from there, he reaches to I, then goes to complex plane. I mean, I, and then pi emerges out of all of that. There is no circle. And then he shows e to the power I pi is minus 1. I can send you the link. I think I have sent Neil that link. I'll try to get that link, put it in chat box too. And I think that is what, and this lecture was happened in 1962, maybe 60 years ago, something like that. And it's still so relevant. And I when I read that whole, heard that whole lecture, it really inspired me. And I think that is what, is most amazing. The non-intuitiveness in a lot of things that we do, if we can bring back, bring some of that to our classrooms, it'll be very amazing. So thank you so much. I had a bunch of things I wanted to show, but I think I mismanaged my time. So thank you so much, Neil, Jam, Sonia, for inviting me to give this talk and share some of our experiences.
Thank you so much, Manish. I think, I don't know if you were following the chat here and on YouTube. I think folks, I think mind blown is roughly the cumulative state or the vibe in the chat. I'll just quickly maybe get to, I think many people were interested in knowing where they can get a catalog of your activities and the kind of things that you're making. So I think some of us have dropped various links in the chat. So I'm going to request everybody who was curious about that to check out the chat. So you're definitely going to have, your minimum Kickstarter audience, I think, right from the live audience. I guess there was a question about whether the paper trick, I assume this is the one about the card sorting, something in that spirit is used in a vending machine. That's a vending with a W. I don't know if that's something you wanted to react to quickly.
I'm just going to give me just 1 minute, Neil. I'm going to put that... that link byproduct Dalia chat me. Okay, Jay has put that chat. So there is something called byproducts or whatever in the link, and right, you can just go there on our website.
And I think you might also want to check out, I think Sundeep Gupta has shared a link to maybe your 3030 STEM and how he is.
I mean, 3030 STEM is interesting. See, the reason these days our website is not working is apparently a lot of people are logging in and we are not prepared, so it crashes. And this and that, whatever, and we will have to do a better job at that. But we're trying to. And so just Google search 3030 STEM or Eklavya, and I think they will take you on YouTube to someplace.
Right.
Yeah, you were asking me about the vending machine. So I
Yeah, that's, I think that was one of the questions that came in from Gaurav Jamodkar. I don't know if Gaurav wanted to elaborate further. Feel free to do that. I think we still have like a couple of minutes to have a quick discussion if you like.
I actually didn't understand the question very well, so I don't know if I will respond. But this card trick, or I don't know about the paper trick. Paper thing was basically folding such that all the lines of, I mean, this is what Eric Demain proved, that as part of his thesis, that any polygon, any closed polygon, you can fold the paper in such a way that with a single cut in one direction, the whole polygon will come out, right? So you can do this for a triangle, and if you do this for a triangle, you will realize that you will have to fold along the perpendicular bisectors, and then angle bisectors, then two lines come together and things like that. So when you do it for a triangle, you can do it for a square, and then so on and so forth, and quadrilateral, and so on and so forth, and you realize that I can, he has formally proved. And so then what we did was extended his, we worked on him, whatever he was doing, and then we did for all the letters of English alphabet. I'm not challenging you, but it'll be nice if we can do the same for other languages, for Hindi language, for Tamil or whatever. Imagine all of them are written with straight lines, so the, and it's a closed polygon, or even if it is not closed, how do you sort of fold it? At what point you will do a valley fold and a mountain fold, so that it, single cut, it comes on with a straight line. Regarding that card trick, something that I have here, basically we are doing radix sort. Right, in base 2, base 3, base 4, base 5. Base 2 is something that you do with one stick. Base 3, you will have to do with two sticks, and so on and so forth. And the most interesting question, which is what we worked with Udit Sanghi, who came to our lab, spent 2 weeks. This guy is some Olympiad medalist, bronze medalist, computational thinking Olympiad medalist, represented India. And he and I were working together, and I came up with this very interesting question, which I didn't have the answer to. If you guys do, please do let me know. In my opinion, it's not a solved problem. Imagine you have these cards, just assume these five binary cards, binary holes, right? These are 26 cards, so I can arrange them in 26 factorial ways. All right, so of course, 26 cards, 26 factorial ways. Using just this stick that I have and these holes, how many of those 26 possible factorial possible combinations are possible? I can use this stick as many times in as many holes, whichever way I want. How many of those are possible, and what, that's it. And then, of course, lots of questions, as a corollary to this basic question. I don't think we have a clear answer yet. We don't think we have. So it'll be nice for you guys to, if there is answer, do send me an email. I'm very curious. I don't know the answer. I don't know how to solve it. So some of the audience maybe can help. That'd be great. This thing that I thought, we call it Up It Up. And this is something also that we solved with Udit. Beautiful solution that we came up with computationally. We wrote a very simple 100-line Python program to solve it. But the goal is very simple. You have these cubes. And on top is IIT Gandhinagar logo. On the bottom is CCL logo, and you have to roll these cubes, right, up and down, so that the bottom part comes up. That's it. You cannot slide this. This is not a permitted move. You only have to roll. So you can roll like this, and then like this, and so on and so forth. Keep rolling. I think the minimum answer that we have is 36 moves. If you have lesser, let us know. If you can write a very simple Python program, 50 lines or something like that, 60 lines, something like that. I mean, the most amazing thing that we did was, encoded this in a 7-bit base number, something like that. So if you're interested, send me an email. We'll be happy to discuss this.
Yeah, so I'm just going to remind everybody that the email is ccl@igjn. I don't see any more questions in the chat, Manish, but when you have some time, you can scroll back up and you'll see a lot of compliments. I think various points when you revealed various things. So thank you so much for sort of sharing, all of this with us. And I don't know what the tradition is. This is the first session. So maybe I can request those of you who are able to just unmute, and we can do a little applause for you, Manish. That was a fantastic session. So thank you
so much. I just wanted to say, if you liked it, it'll be nice if you can go register for whatever it's a dream program. Would like to see all of you there. Thank you so much. Thank you, Jam, Sonia. Thank you so much. I don't know, you called me here to do this talk. I messed up on time. I had few things that I couldn't, but hopefully nazar badli to nazare and wo jo bhi jo dialogue tha wo chal gaya. Thank you so much.
So in English, the suggestion is, if you change the way you look, what you see changes.
Wow. Okay. So I try to remember that, but you know, I
keep speaking. I don't remember. Okay.
All right. So I'm going to have this, I think, back to Sonia. I believe we are in a break right now and the panel discussion starts at 4:45. Sonia, if you missed anything, you know, please go.
We will not.
Thank you so much, Neil. Yeah. And thank you, Manish, for a wonderful session. Over to you, Sabita.
Wow, the conference started off with a bang, no words. Thank you, Manish and Nildara. It was indeed a splendid session and loved appetizing the curriculum and spicing it up, the need for the hour. Thanks once again. After this engaging session, break to banta hai. So while you get your tea or coffee mugs, we will make some couple of announcements. So stay tuned. You would have seen the program schedule. So we have organized a cultural program on 2nd of October after the conference. So those interested to take part are requested to send your details to Mrs. Swati Sumesh. We have the phone number displayed on, so you can put in your WhatsApp message to her. The dance perform, you can have a dance performance or a song, shayari, one act play, riddles. Any of these forms can be taken up. But there are limited seats, so kindly hurry. Registration closes on 1st of October. As you all know, that CTIS conference always have talks by eminent speakers. So we just now had Manish James, an interesting session. So tonight we have Patricia Ordinos, who is an associate professor in the Department of Computer Science at the University of Puerto Rico, Rio Piedras. So request you all not to forget to join the keynote session at 8:30 tonight. So we have a couple of poll questions. So if we could just play the, yeah. So I think after the lovely session, let us know how do you all feel. Are you all happy, excited, tired or sad?
You can see it.
No, we are all excited over here, so I'm not sure.
Can't take it.
Okay, sorry, you all can't take it. You need to answer the whole session over here. So then, come. We have the three musketeers of the day standing over here. Please come. Manish and Neil Dhara, that was a wonderful session. I think you have geared up the complete audience.
It's started.
Thank you. Bang. A lot of energy. Thank you, Manish. Excellent. It was excellent.
Yeah. The three musketeers of the day today.
It is nice
and
to see
Manish
you guys.
Manish is familiar because every Sunday we meet. Right.
No, this Sunday was very, very nervous for me. It was first time after a long time and I was sweating all over and but you know, we'll see. We can do better. I'm sorry, I'm really mismanaged on time, Neil. My iPad was not working in the beginning, you know, lots of things are going wrong.
It was well managed.
So I messed up in terms of time. There are very interesting things that I thought I wanted to show, but I just
I don't think it matters at all, Manish. If you what's in the chat and the poll, like, आपने बताया नहीं होता तो किसी को पता नहीं चलता. I think just that you're saying it, but I think everyone had a blast as you can tell. So yeah, I think it was fantastic. And as I said, I think every single one of the demonstrations that you did, it's always, as I said, I mean, I'm not even seeing many of them for the first time and, you know, I'm still, my mind is blown. So I think it was a treat for everyone who was seeing it perhaps for the first time. So yeah, I think, So comment in the chat from Susanna, I guess you brought out the child in us. I completely agree. So yeah, thanks Manish.
Pleasure, pleasure.
So welcome back. Hope you all had your tea and coffee. Right. So it has been a tough year for all of us due to the pandemic. And teachers have come up with innovative approaches during the pandemic to enhance the teaching learning process in the virtual mode too. Let us tighten our seatbelts for CT during pandemic panel discussion chaired by Janaki Ghosh from Lady Sriram College of Women, New Delhi. Welcome, Janaki. Over to you.
Thank you so much. A warm welcome to all the attendees, all the participants into this panel discussion on computational thinking during the pandemic. So after, what should I say, a visual, mathematical, and a computational treat by Professor Manish Jain, so we have embarked on this discussion. So the COVID-19 pandemic has led to a major disruption in education across the country. And during this period, lack of student engagement and massively unequal access to online education have presented two of the overarching barriers when planning for continuation of education. So although schools in the country have made various attempts to reach out to students in synchronous as well as asynchronous modes, the loss of learning, as we all know, has been tremendous at all levels. And coming to the context of this conference, everyone has acknowledged the importance of computational thinking in school education. Everyone wants to implement CT in education, especially its importance being heightened also after its mention in the National Education Policy. Way back in 2006, it was Jeanette Wing's article in which she said that computational thinking is a fundamental skill for everyone, not just for computer scientists. So to reading, writing, and arithmetic, the three R's, we should add computational thinking to every child's analytical ability. And that popularized this term greatly, though of course computational thinking as a term was around much before that. And so CT is said to entail skills, you know, such as the ability to deal with open-ended problems, persistence and confidence in dealing with complexity, representing ideas in computationally meaningful ways, breaking down problems into simpler ones, creating abstractions, assessing strengths and weaknesses of a representation, generating algorithmic solutions, so on. And tools and strategies which allow scientists and engineers to collect and analyze data sets, search for distinctive patterns, identify relationships and significant features in ways that were earlier probably not possible. I mean, technology has made this possible. So despite these, list of skills and definitions, there appear to be a limited understanding of computational thinking outside of perhaps a computer science framework or a STEM framework. And most importantly, computational thinking is a way of thinking, a habit of mind which needs to be developed from the early years. But it is also important to understand how teachers and educators who are engaging with students on an everyday basis, how they perceive computational thinking and about what they feel about how it should be integrated in various subjects across the curriculum. The online mode has also led to a greater dependency on computers and digital tools, and there are two sides to this. So on one hand, online learning may provide a greater opportunity for integrating CT-based activities in teaching. But on the other hand, CT may be viewed as a multifaceted, adaptable tool that can be used for all kinds of learning, be it hybrid or even face-to-face. So this panel discussion will focus on some of the initiatives and activities that individual teachers or schools undertook to integrate computational thinking in the teaching learning process during the pandemic. And these include a range of activities from unplugged activities to coding-based ones, which engage students in computational thinking and also on capacity building of teachers. Further, we need to deliberate on what steps need to be undertaken to continue to integrate computational thinking in the school curriculum, even as schools are in the process of reopening and resumption. So we have three very experienced persons as panelists to deliberate on this theme: Rajati Chandramohan, Priyanka, and Gauri Joshi. So we will request them to share their views on the theme. And after that, we will invite questions from the audience to take the discussion further. So two of them will be sharing their views through, we'll be playing their video, but they are of course here to answer questions later. So Rajati Chandramohan, the first speaker, is a mathematics teacher who has been teaching in Valal S.I. Alarkswamy Higher Secondary School in Chennai. She has 20 years of experience in teaching, is very passionate about her profession. She integrates many different activities in her teaching and spends a lot of time in motivating students to understand and enjoy mathematics. And one of her primary aims is to remove the fear of mathematics in children. She will share about how she integrated some mathematical games and puzzles in her teaching and led students to engage in computational thinking during the pandemic period. So I request that Rajati's video be played. Thank you.
Good evening, one and all present here. First, I thank God Almighty to give this wonderful opportunity to share my experiences with great people gathered here in the annual Computational Thinking Conference 2021 and hope we overcome this pandemic and back to regular lead. I am Mrs. Rajati Chandramohan from Vallal Esai Arhasami Chettiar Higher Secondary School, Royapuram, at Chennai in India. I am very glad to be a part of this conference. My presentation is on the topic Impact of CT Activities on Students' Learning During Pandemic Situation. When I want to say about my school, our school is located in North Chennai near the seashore. It is a government-aided upper primary cum higher secondary school with 30 teachers. Nearly 1,100 students are there in the school and our parents are fishermen and daily wagers. CT in Max was introduced in the year 2018. In our school locality, we can see women in groups play traditional games like Dayan, that is throwing dice, Pallanguri using tamarind seeds, and Adupuliyattam, that is tiger and goats, in groups. During pandemic, children spend a lot of time watching movies on TV and playing games in mobile. So, to connect the context with curriculum, I introduced the activity Magic Triangle. My aim is to focus on unplugged activities and games which rejuvenate the children at home during lockdown. Coming to Magic Triangle, the word magic itself made children to think something fun, play a game, and very curious to listen. I gave the simple task, that is to fill the numbers from 1 to 6 in the magic circles without repetition. So the numbers in all the sides of the triangle give the same sum. To warm up the children's mind for the Magic Triangle activity, I started with preparation step. Here students were allowed to discuss and share their views. As a result, they came up with number line, focus more solution in number operations, that is addition of numbers. It shifts the thinking process from regular to open-ended problem that relates to Magic Triangle. Student found more than one solution and emphasis multiple path of inquiry in problem solving. We can see students involved CT skills in preparation steps like breaking up numbers, strategy of choosing first small numbers and then large numbers, finally adding small number to large number to get the sum. Here we can observe analogous thinking beginning with identifying the correct path. Then step-by-step process, that is algorithm, leads to find the solution both in regular and open-ended problem. In the implementation step of Magic Triangle activity, students easily solve the Magic Triangle after practicing open-ended problems. Magic Sum 9 was done with the teacher's guidance in the online classes. Then students solve the Magic Sum 10 by themselves at home and send it through the WhatsApp group.
Hi everyone, today we are all put the magic triangle. You are all ready? So first, you draw the triangle in your chart. Okay, then you put the circle in your triangle and your magic stars, your magic summers, 10. One coin. So, 1. Then, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and then 6 plus 6. 1, 2, 3. So 3 is equal to 1 plus 6 is 7. 7 plus 3 is 10. So finally, the sum is 10.
Finally, coming to the main part of the presentation, Impact of CT Activities on Students' Learning. In the lockdown time, students, even elders, felt homesick. This magic triangle activity made them to overcome the scenario and got a chance to play with their parents. They developed mathematical skills of pattern recognition, abstract thinking, and algorithm skills like selection and elimination. It kindled their creativity. After practicing these types of activities, they were ready to accept the international challenges like Debras without fear. I took initiative and motivated the students to participate in Bebras Challenge 2020, where 35 students participated and 4 students achieved the reward best of the school. Students also show interest in solving newspaper puzzles like Magic Square, Sudoku and so on. That means student approaches mathematics with confidence more casually without fear than before. Instead playing games and watching videos on mobile, they have fun with math puzzles. As they got the opportunity to discuss with their parents, grandparents, siblings, neighbors about the puzzle, they relate and coordinate with the traditional games like Pallanguri, Dayam, Pallatam and so on. As an impact, they form mini club to play math games. Here, I wish to explain briefly about the great epic Mahabharatam famous Dayam game. Dayakatti is a board game played from ancient time in Tamil Nadu. There is no Mahabharatam without the incident of Dayam playing, where Gauravas defeated Pandavas in this game. The game is that each player have 6 coins, move the coins from home to target as per the line given in the picture. Who reach all 6 coins first to the center is a winner. From the above game, students probed out CT skills also involved in traditional games like who is the winner, what is the winning position, how should the game be played when one player is considered out of the game. That is, one player cut all the 6 coins by the opponent player. The significant impact of the magic triangle made the students to find out CT skill in the traditional game. Before, people in the community played these traditional games without having awareness of mathematical skills and CT skills involved in it. Now, they have learnt what is CT skills, and also the CT skills in traditional games enables participants to engage in looking for the optimal strategy, pattern recognition, quick calculation, developing fine motor skills, eye-hand coordination and decision-making skill. Finally, I conclude that magic triangle activity made big boom travel, reaching CT skills from teacher to students and students to community. At last, I like to share the feedback. One of the parents of the student, Kirtika, said that instead of children sitting in front of the TV or smartphone for hours due to its addictive quality is only going to increase obesity and lethargic behavior. The other parent of the student, Bada Prakash, said no awareness about these games in the current generation. Teachers even suggest these games be introduced in schools. The sister of student, Madhumita, said many IT companies are now making use of these activities and games for the staff for leadership training or as de-stressors. Many start playing and remark that the game stimulates thinking capacity. One of our science teacher mentioned that Pallanguri, besides being a great way to strengthen mathematical concepts, is an excellent braille game as it involves touching and feeling. It is even prescribed to improve arthritis. One of my students, Swati, said that after doing this activity and playing these games, I became fast in adding numbers and increasing memory power. With this, I end my presentation and I thank one and all present here for giving this wonderful opportunity. Thank you. Thank you very much.
So thank you very much, Rajati, for that wonderful presentation, which gave us a real glimpse into the way you integrated so many interesting puzzles and games with your students. And it went further into the community as well. So I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions from the audience after this. Now we move on to the second speaker, Priyanka. So Priyanka has an experience of a decade in working in the education space, which spans across social enterprise, NGO, edtech, and government projects. Her recent most stint was a two-year fellowship with the Department of Social Welfare, Government of Andhra Pradesh, in the academic vertical of social welfare, residential, educational, institutional society. As an academic fellow, she also managed the Nipunya Vikasam, a skill development project that had CT as a focus area. In this panel discussion, she will draw from her experiences of her fellowship and add insights into the theme of computational thinking during the pandemic. We welcome you, Priyanka. So please, over to you for your presentation.
Thank you, Chinaki. So let me just quickly share my screen. Hope my presentation is visible.
Yes.
Thank you, Jinaki, and thank you to the CTIS team for giving me this opportunity. So first, let me kind of set a context of what was it like during the pandemic, 2020, March 22nd, the national lockdown was declared for 3 weeks. And during that 3 weeks, we were hoping that, you know, the children would come back to school after that 3 weeks and then resume their academic activities and things like that. But then what really happened was that the lockdown kept extending from days to weeks to months. It was not anticipated at all. So during this time, the reality started hitting us really hard. While all the classes were sent home, there were these one batch of grade 10 and who were yet to give their public exams. And then we started by understanding how we can like engage them from home, and we started exploring the online teaching or something like that. Let's just go back to March last year. All of us were kind of, we all used Zoom. But then in an academic perspective, in an academic context, using Zoom on a regular basis was not something that was really kind of like, you know, present. So it was quite new for the teachers, as well as it was quite new for the management as well to kind of implement this. So once the children went home, mainly the 10 standards, and they had to have their revisions and things like that, we started connecting to students to find out ways in which they can still be in touch with the teachers and revise. That was when it all started, where we understood the challenges of the availability of smartphones with students. So this is what it looked like, you know. Almost 50 to 60% of the students had smartphones. And then, you know, when they had, smartphones, the connectivity to internet was very poor, and they were in remotely located villages. Like, you know, the villages that were kind of near the district headquarters had a good connectivity. But then when it came to kind of villages that were a little away, mainly in hill stations and near the coastal areas and all that, the connectivity was always poor. It was a 2G connection typically. And then students did have smartphone access all through the day. So when we initially started off like, you know, getting the data of smartphone availability for class 10, because they had to appear for public exams. But over the months, we slowly started doing this exercise for the rest of the classes also. Because class 10, luckily the government was able to kind of start some special programs on Doordarshan to help them revise for their upcoming public exam. But for the rest of the classes, so as the time progressed, the 10th standard exams were also like cancelled and everything. And then come June, July, we really had to like understand what was the smartphone availability and how we can go about. And that is where I draw these insights that are there on the slide. So students didn't have smartphone access all through the day, while 50 to 60% of the parents did have access, as I mentioned earlier. They didn't have access all through the day, which meant that, you know, the parents were actually taking their phones to their employment, I mean, with them when they go for work or something like that. And this was the phase when the lockdown was lifted and the partial lockdown were imposed. So the schools were not open, but the parents had started going, going for work and all that. And the smartphones were available mostly in the evening. Then came another limitation, wherein a challenge rather, wherein the daily data limitation. I think this is something we can all empathize. Like, you know, every day we know that we have a 2 GB or a 3 GB limit in most of our mobile phones when it comes to data. While most of us here use broadband connection and have unlimited access and all that, we should understand that in the rural, smartphone is the main main device with which they access internet. Laptops and routers or laptops or broadband are not something that are easily available. So this daily data limitation was a challenge wherein it offered very less scope for online classes. So the context goes like this, like, you know, the phones were available for the students before 8 a.m. So if you had to conduct an online class, it had to be before 8 a.m. Also because the parent during their travel time and all that to work, they use the phone for WhatsApp or to check social media or news or something like that, which would kind of consume the data. And by the time they get back in the evening, at least half of the data limitation or half of the data quota would have got over. So which meant that even if we had to have online classes, it had to be before 8 a.m. in the morning and not in the evening, because in the evening, not much students were able to join due to the less data limit that they had. And then finally, something that I think the schools and everybody followed were having WhatsApp group. Even if it was going to be 50 to 60% of the students who had access, let's all bring them together through a WhatsApp group is what was taught. So the class teacher was formed the WhatsApp group with the students of her particular class and section. And then once the students joined, there were, so here again, one more pattern that was noticed is the more remote the school, the less number of participants in the WhatsApp group, because again, the access was a problem. They didn't have smartphones or anything. So then this WhatsApp group, one more thing that we saw, I personally was a part of at least 30 to 40 WhatsApp group. And one pattern that came across was the response was very less. So, you know, before I could go more into details, let me also kind of quickly let you know that the teachers were given enough capacity building during the pandemic to understand how to create WhatsApp group, how to use virtual conferences like Zoom or Google Hangout, how to use Google Forms, how to make a little bit of presentations and all those things. So they were kind of very well prepared. So the teachers had a lesson plan wherein they were planning to execute it, like, you know, have textbook notes and then kind of send supporting videos and then kind of send forms for assessment and everything. So once they started sending all this on WhatsApp group, the response from the students was not overwhelming. You know, the response was not so great. It was hardly a few students, like probably 10 to 20% of the students who responded. And the response time was also very different because some would do it in the night because they got the phone only then and all of it. So then the participation in the WhatsApp group was something that was not great. And this kind of, again, was posing a very serious challenge of not having a, like, you know, a feedback mechanism to understand what the children were learning and like, you know, did they understand or anything like that. Not even doubts would come on some of those WhatsApp groups. So these are some of the challenges that were there, you know, when we started off. And some, even now, some of these challenges still do exist. So then now let's move on to some of the opportunities we had during the pandemic, some of the initiatives that were taken to kind of combat some of these challenges, at the same time to also kind of add a fresh dimension to online learning. So the skill development department had a dedicated YouTube channel wherein the IT and CT trainers recorded short videos and posted it there. So once it got posted, like that link was shared in these WhatsApp groups for the students on the concepts that were relevant to their classes. The students could see it and learn from that. And then now since the schools were not working full-fledged physically and all those things. One of the things that we kind of thought was to capitalize this time for capacity building for the trainers in the Naipunya Vikasam program. So there was a webinar and a learning circle model that was there, wherein we got all the trainers together. They would see a webinar, and then they would be broken down into groups, breakout rooms, and have a learning circle. So this learning circle model was very interesting, wherein these smaller groups, the learning circle had a learning circle moderator who would kind of delve deeper into the theme of the day that was kind of like set by the webinar. The tone was set by the webinar. And then in the breakout rooms, all the trainers, since they were in smaller groups, they shared their inhibitions and shared whatever they learned or whatever doubts they had with the learning circle moderator. And they were able to address a lot of gaps in the key concept areas. And then they also had an opportunity to learn from the peers of other districts and other schools whom they had not interacted so far. So this also promoted peer learning. And apart from that, the same model we also followed for some professional development programs, which kind of helped each and every trainer to become confident and learn something that they can take back into the classrooms. So then we also did something called a showcase event, wherein the last year CTIS, some of the abstracts that the trainer submitted were filtered and were shortlisted. But then only one or two got selected for the final day. So instead we thought, why can't we have the ones that were kind of selected for the initial round to kind of have a showcase event to show what they had actually presented in the abstract, and also help the other, motivate the other trainers around them to make a similar attempt for upcoming conferences and things like that. So this showcase event was a huge motivation for them, and it also helped people like me to go deeper into what was happening on the field and understand the different practices they followed in the classrooms when it came to CT implementation. So finally, when the school reopened, all of us might think the challenges, yes, it has been addressed, the children are all at school and everything like that. But there were still a few challenges, I would say. So some of them was, we had to ensure that the planned IT and CT sessions were conducted. You know, the children had a lot of learning gaps and the focus was a lot into academics. Some of the members of school management would think can we take the IT and the CT periods for this? Because they had to be math, science and all that syllabus completed and everything like that. So we had to ensure and make the school understand that these IT and CT periods also have to go on. And then the next thing is, we thought one way to do that was to increase the visibility of these IT and CT periods are important. So we came up with an abridged version of the syllabus that had only the key concepts of CT that had to be implemented. So this gave a visibility to the schools to kind of carry on the regular IT and CT periods and kind of have that also as a stronger component in the timetable. So this also kind of helped us consolidate a lot of important topics, and we encouraged the teachers to kind of use very creative ways, unplugged activities and other ways to kind of impart them some learning that they can take from the capacity building sessions that they had. And we also did something very interesting, wherein we implemented a scratch program capacity building, wherein these trainers had actually